to our service of worship. I'd ask you to rise as we turn our attention to the Lord in His word. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad.
As we also forgive our
Chapter 19. Thus says Jehovah, go and get a potter's earthen flask, that's another type of a vessel, and take some of the elders of the people and some of the elders of the priests, and say, thus says Jehovah of armies, the God of Israel, behold, I will bring such a catastrophe on this place that whoever hears of it, his ears will tingle, because they have forsaken me. Then you shall break the flask in the sight of the men who go with you, and say to them, thus says Jehovah of armies, even so I will break this people and the city as one breaks a potter's vessel, which cannot be made whole again, because they have stiffened their necks, that they might not hear my words. Amen. So two stories, but in the second story, he was talking about them getting an earthen flask. This is a cup. It's like a vessel. You could maybe picture it as a flask. Do you recognize anything on this? It's the church and school, yes, right on there. So this is a flask, and the Lord told Jeremiah in the second story to take an earthen flask and take all the elders of the people and tell them that because they had stiffened their necks and they had not listened to what the Lord said, that he was going to bring catastrophe, disaster on the place, and he told them to take it and smash it in the sight of the people. What do you think would happen if I smashed this? Did it break? Might look something like this. What do you see on this? It was the same flask. Little pieces there. Now, does this look like it would be any good for a cup of coffee in the morning?
No.
What do you think?
No?
Do you think you could mold this back together for me and make this? Could you do that? Any of you could put this together? Mold that with your fingers? Why can't you mold that? Feel it? It's hard. Once it becomes hardened, if it breaks, you can't fix it anymore. It's broken. You'll never drink coffee out of this again. It said it can't be healed once it is hardened like this. So that becomes a worthless type of vessel. But in our earlier story, the Lord was talking about us being clay in the Lord's hands. So you can see with this clay, if I had enough clay and enough time this morning, I could mold this into a vessel that could again receive something into it. What kind of things do we put in cups?
Coffee.
Drinks. We put juice, things like that is what we put in vessels. What if I told you are like a vessel? Each one of us is like a vessel, and what do you think the Lord puts into us? Love, and there's one other thing. Mercy, very good. Love, mercy, and also His truth. That's what the Lord fills us with. And as long as we are like clay in His hands, as long as we're moldable, the Lord can continue to make this vessel bigger, more beautiful, more open, more receptive to His love and to His wisdom. And the Lord can fill us with that. And if we make mistakes and the Lord sees there's a little bit of damage in it, maybe a tiny little hole, something like that, as long as we're pliable, the Lord can fix that, because we're like clay in His hands and He can make us whole again. But the warning in the second story was that if we become hard by not listening to the Lord's word, not caring what He says, eventually we will become so hardened against the Lord that He won't be able to mold us anymore into a vessel that is receptive of Him. And so He gave that dramatic warning to Jeremiah to say to the people, you're not listening to the Lord. And things are going badly for you right now. And if you do it long enough, eventually you're going to be so hardened against the Lord that you're going to be broken and the Lord isn't going to be able to fix you. So the key to these stories is in the clay. The Lord is the potter. We are the clay. And the question is, what kind of clay do you want to be? Do you want to be hard or soft? Soft. Absolutely. You want to be soft. And we're told the way that we keep ourselves soft, the way we remain moldable, is when we are willing to listen to what the Lord says. It's really pretty simple. If you approach the Lord in His Word, and when you read His word, if you say, I really want to find out what the Lord says. And then when you read it, if you see things in your life that don't line up with what the Lord says, instead of saying, I don't like what the Lord says, I'm not going to listen, you say, wow, I'm not listening to what the Lord says. I need to change what I'm doing to match what the Lord says in His word. And as long as we have that attitude of being willing to listen to the Lord, our hearts will remain soft, and we will forever be moldable clay in the Lord's hands, and He will be able to form us into His image and likeness. Amen. Please rise for the blessing of the Lord. The Lord give His angels charge over you to thank you.
divide into six, and they're called the days of creation.
become something, though only a little, then something more, until the sixth day is reached, where it says he becomes an image. Meanwhile, the Lord is constantly fighting on his behalf against evils and falsities, and by these conflicts is confirming him in truth and good. The hour of conflict is the hour when the Lord is at work, which is why in the prophets a regenerate person is called the work of God's fingers. Nor does he rest until love is playing the leading part, at which point the conflict ceases. When that work has reached the point where faith has been joined to love, then it is called very good. For the Lord then moves him to be a likeness of himself. No holiness is a person's own. Rather, it is the Lord's presence with the person. Those who humble themselves in the belief that they are holy of themselves and who offer adoration from a love of God which begins in themselves, humble themselves and offer adoration from self-love, thus from a hard heart of stone and not from a soft heart of flesh. Also, they are interested only in external things and not at the same time in internal ones. For self-love lives in the external man and cannot enter the internal, because the internal man is opened solely by love to and faith in the Lord. Thus, by the Lord, who there forms for the person the heaven in which he lives. Amen. Here end our lessons. Blessed are those who hear the word of God.
Then God said, "Let us make man
our likeness. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. It's interesting when we hear these words often throughout most of our lives, we hear created in the image and the likeness of God, and we don't think that there's any discernible difference between the two. It's a phrase that rolls off our tongue, image and likeness. But it's interesting to reflect after our readings about whether or not we are an image of God, or a likeness of God, or maybe in some ways we are not either yet. So that's what we're going to be talking about this morning, is what it is to be in the image and likeness of God. And we'll see there's a little bit of both, that in fact, part of being an image and likeness of God is from creation. He created us to be an image and likeness of himself. And part of it is also an ongoing process, that being molded into an image and likeness of God. It is a vast topic, but we're going to look at three basic areas: how we are created from the beginning as an image and likeness, the difference between those two terms, and how it is that we become an image and likeness, that ongoing process of being molded into the form of the Lord. So how we are created as an image of and likeness. We're told we are created as an image of God because of our capacity to receive his love and wisdom. The Lord is love and wisdom itself, but we are an image of him because he created us as vessels that could receive that love and wisdom. So we are an image, not because we have love and wisdom of our own, but because he created us to receive that. So we are an image of him in that way. Here's the interesting thing. We're told we are a likeness, created a likeness of the Lord, because we have the ability to feel as though those things we receive are our own. This is really talking about the program. The Lord gave us the sense, the feeling, that our love and our wisdom are our own. Makes us a likeness of God. Really, love and wisdom are the Lord's alone. They're not ours. But he gave us the gift from the beginning of having that program where we could feel as though the love and wisdom which we receive from him are actually ours. And we know this to be true in our daily lives. When we have love for our spouse or for friend, we don't feel as though it's the Lord loving them through us. We feel that's our love. And the Lord gave us that gift. So in that way, we are a likeness, created in the likeness of God, and that we feel love and wisdom as our own. But we're an image in that we are created with the capacity to receive. And the gift of being the likeness is that we actually have the sensation that those things are our own, even though they're not. And this being created in the image and likeness of God is essentially what distinguishes us from animals and makes us truly human. We have the ability to understand from his divine truth and to love as if from ourselves. We are born ignorant, without truth, to develop this as of self. If you were pre-programmed, similar to how an animal is, but all you need to know sort of right from the beginning, discovery. But the Lord has created us where everything that we learn, everything that we take in and begin to understand, we feel as though it's our own. And without this as a self, we're told we could not be freely conjoined to our Creator. It is that degree of separation from the Lord that allows us to freely return His love. Because of the space that the Lord gives us and that program that allows us to feel apart from the Lord, we can freely choose to understand His truth, and we can freely choose to love Him in return. If the Lord pre-programmed you with everything and didn't give you any sense of autonomy, you could not make the free choice to love Him in return. We're told that all love has to be reciprocal. And this is why God created us in His image and likeness, so that we could feel life as our own and then freely choose to return it to the Lord. So what is the difference between those two terms, being an image and a likeness? It is essentially the difference between the will and the understanding, between love and wisdom, between the celestial and the spiritual, and between good and truth. And so we are told that we are an image of the Lord and becoming an image of the Lord more and more when we acknowledge and believe that all good and truth comes from the Lord. That's the first step, is because the Lord gave us that gift of self-life and feeling as though life is our own, the first step in truly becoming an image of the Lord is to recognize that, in fact, it all flows in. And acknowledge that. And so we need to seek after the Lord's truth and wisdom and receive it in our understanding and be that vessel. This is so important in becoming an image of the Lord, is to recognize that you are not the potter. You are the clay. He is the one that makes you a vessel that is capable of receiving Him. And as long as we don't flip it and think that we're actually the potter, we're in pretty good shape. As long as we recognize we are the vessel that receives from the Lord, and we have to actively seek out the Lord to fill our understanding with His truth. We're told this is spiritual love. The love of truth, but not just the love of truth for the sake of truth alone, but we're told specifically the love of truth for the sake of being able to serve our neighbors. If you are going to the Lord in His Word with the idea that I want to better be able to serve my fellow man, you will be receiving the Lord's truth in a spiritual way, and He will teach you how to treat your neighbor properly in all kinds of situations, both easy and difficult. We're told that this, living that truth that we have sought out in the Lord for the sake of the neighbor, is the sixth day state of regeneration. Faith is living because we are practicing it, but there is still this idea that truth is the leading part with us. Being a likeness, or becoming a likeness of the Lord, not merely an image, but a likeness, which it said is like an exact replica, is one, as we mentioned before, because we feel that life is our own. But now we specifically have a desire for God's goodness and love, and to receive that into ourselves as a vessel. And we genuinely love now plays the leading role. Yes, we love the Lord's truth. We go to it to teach us how to treat our neighbor, but there's a switch that happens where doesn't vanish. It's not as though we don't care about truth anymore. Truth is what got us to this place where that switch can happen, where love begins to take the leading role, and truth is there to help us out. This, we're told, is the seventh-day state of regeneration, the celestial state. And in this state, love is prized over wisdom and goodness over truth, but we truly see how the two go together hand in hand. So there is that difference between being an image of the Lord is good, being a likeness of the Lord is great. So how do we become an image and likeness of the Lord? We have to receive the wisdom and love from God, and we have to live according to His commandments. This interesting passage from Divine Providence number 328 says that as recipient vessels, people receive in lesser or greater degree according to what they have from religion, according to their knowledge of God and of His commandments, and consequently, according to their knowledge of His truths. For truths teach who God is, and how He is to be acknowledged, and also what His commandments are, and how a person is supposed to live according to them. And so the Lord says in the Gospel of John, he who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. This road from being initially created to have the capacity to be an image and likeness of God is a long road where we allow the Lord to form us into that. And the chief thing is to go to the Lord and to live according to His commandments. As we said in the children's talk, it's one thing to get in the habit of going to the Lord and His Word, but as you get older, you inevitably will come across things in the Old Testament, the New Testament, and the heavenly doctrines that challenge you. You look at it and you don't like what it says. And the key when we have those challenges in our life is being willing to bow our understanding and our will to what the Lord says. And if we can look at it and say, yes, my understanding is not in accordance with that. I need to change my understanding to fit that in. Or if you look and you say, my life is not in accordance with what the Lord is teaching, I need to change what I'm doing. That allows the Lord to continue to mold us in His image and likeness. Throughout the Word, we see the consequences of people who do not allow the Lord to mold them. What does it say about the Pharaoh repeatedly in his interactions with Moses? He hardened his heart. The Pharaoh hardened his heart. He heard what the Lord was saying. He didn't like it, and he hardened his heart. And as we talk to the children, the more we are in the pattern of hardening our heart against what the Lord says, the harder it becomes for the Lord to rework us, remold us when we make mistakes, because we reach a point where we don't want to hear what the Lord says anymore. We simply want to do our own will. And so we have to keep ourselves soft and quiet. What is it that causes us to have that hard heart? In a nutshell, it is two things. You might say the opposites of being in the image and likeness of the Lord. It is the love of our own intelligence and the love of ourselves. The love of our own intelligence, conceit, arrogance, pride, those are the things that stand in the way of us not being in the image of the Lord, not being willing to receive His truth and His wisdom into our lives because we think our ideas are better than His. And And then the love of self, the love of dominion, is on the will side where we want what we want. And it may not be what the Lord wants. We see this so often in interactions we have with other people where we're more concerned with what we get out of it than we are with what they're going to get out of it. And so we want, inherently, there's a part in us that wants people to serve us, to do things our way, and to meet all our needs. But the Lord says, no, you need to be willing to bow your own desires, your will, to mine. And if we are willing to bow our will to the Lord, if we're willing to bow our understanding to the Lord, we can keep ourselves moldable and quiet. But if we harden ourselves against Him, eventually we will reach a point where, even if we hear the Lord's word being read, we won't receive anything from it because we'll be so hardened in our own ideas, in our own ways. So what keeps our hearts soft? How do we receive that heart of flesh spoken in Ezekiel, where the Lord said, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. First and foremost is simply humility. That ongoing acknowledgement that the Lord is the potter and we are the clay. We must constantly fight against the desire to be the potter, as in the making of idols. Think about that whole narrative in the Old Testament. What do they do continually? They have the Lord, but no, they go out and they make idols out of their own hands to worship. It's such a tangible image of us thinking we are the creator, we are the potter, but you're really just making stuff in your own image that you can worship. So creating idols really is just loving yourself, your own ideas, your own creation. So we have to continually remind ourselves, no, there is only one God, and that is the Lord. And that makes us all clay. And if we have that humility to recognize we're all on the same playing field, none of us is better than the other, and then that keeps us all looking to the Lord as our Creator. So humility is first, and the second is obedience. Just having the will to say, I'm going to do what the Lord says, even when I don't want to. The Lord's given me this ability to compel myself to do His will, and to understand His truth in His way, and if we're obedient in that way, we will keep ourselves soft and pliable. If we are soft and pliable, as we said with the children, it doesn't mean we're perfect yet. What it means is when we make a mistake and the vessel is marred, we're in the habit of acknowledging our mistakes and allowing the Lord to remold us and fix us and continue to form us into something beautiful in His image and likeness. So think about the whole span of the word. Genesis starts out with the creations of the heavens and the earth, and then the book of Revelation, right in the last two chapters, is talking about the creation of a new heaven and a new earth. And this really is talking about the span of the Lord from our initial creation in His image and likeness to perfecting that and continually molding us to be a new image and likeness of Him. And so there is this process that we go through throughout our lives where we have to be reformed and regenerated into God's true image and likeness. And so the Lord says, unless man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. We have to allow the Lord to to mold us continually into His image and likeness. Let us have the humility, the innocence, and the trust to allow the Lord to continually mold us into that image and likeness, even as it says in Jeremiah and Isaiah, "Look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter, and all we are the work of your hands." Amen. Please rise. Now to the one only God, Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory and dominion forever and ever.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.